neither one of these teams, I don't think, has got 10 returns yet. Most of the time, the ball is making it into the end zone. So not quite the same threat, but we've talked about this ad nauseum, that the fact they do it is for injury, so you can't blame them for that.
Yeah.
Colquitt's defense is out on the field already. Do you want to set that for us?
Absolutely. Got Wayne Jackson, Brett Smith, Travis Register, and Jameis Pittman, on the lines. Bradley Gray and Washington are the linebackers. Ward Blackwell, Scott Phillips are the defensive backfield.
Lowndes hands it off on first down across the 20, maybe to the 22 or 23-yard line. I give you the assignment of telling me on the defense, you must have to say the whole defensive team was in on that tackle.
It appears so. Run right up the middle, and just a ton of Colquitt defensive players closing in.
They spread their tackles around pretty well. Their linebackers make a lot of them. Gray is 66, Washington 59, but their frontmen make a lot of tackles. Usually the frontmen are just kind of knocking them down for the defensive backs, but here they make a lot of tackles. Second down, end around, it comes to Clement. So, no, 21 at the 25, 26. First down for Nick Bergham coming out of the back, or coming out of the wing position to pick up the first down for Lowndes.
Really impressive job by the Lowndes offensive line on that play. They've really kind of seemed to be controlling the line of scrimmage. Both offensive lines are doing a great job at creating space and pushing their men off the ball.
Berkman has run 184 for 184 yards, and he scored 3 touchdowns for them on the season. Not part of the three-headed monster, but one of their really good players. He comes in motion right now from the shotgun. Hand off to the man in the behind him. Maybe gains a yard or two. So I actually describe that as a pistol. I think anytime they put a man behind the quarterback, that shortens up the snap and call it the pistol rather than the shotgun. They're not going to open it up too much, so that'll be more their spread formation will be more of that pistol rather than the 5-yard snap, more like a 3-yard snap. Now the quarterback will go back under center, I believe. Mike Moore is back in the game. Two receivers flank to the bottom of the screen, one to the top of the screen. Man comes in motion. Fake the handoff to the man. The quarterback rolls to the right side. Big blocking out in front of him, but they strip the blocking, and yet another hit. Josh, I saw you coil back. He really hit him hard.
This Colquitt defense is just flying around, and John Gray is absolute proof of that. The junior is just really, really playing very aggressive football.
The quarterback, I think, is still down. He took quite a hit here. Let's see if we can see this on the replay. There's actually 2 Lowndes players down. We'll go to a break here in just a minute, but let's see if we can get, first off, who the injuries. I'm afraid. No, the quarterback's up, so it's not the quarterback. It was actually the man trying to throw a block from him, and he did get up, and that's their all-star player, Josh Clemens, who was knocked down on that play trying to throw a block. But they have called a timeout, so with 4 minutes and 23 seconds, we'll take one with them. We'll be back with the third down play after this timeout.
Hi, I'm Mark Wahlberg. Join us on our search for America's hidden treasures.
I've never seen this poster come to market before. That could be good and bad. Right? It could be a fake.
Really? Oh, my God. I have goosebumps. They're going up my legs. Oh, my gosh.
Next time from Atlantic City, New Jersey on Antiques Roadshow.
Monday at 8 on GPB.
Third down and 7 from the 36-yard line. Lowndes has 1 first down in this drive. Would like to keep the ball and keep it away from Colquitt. Back to throw on the left side. Throws a pass behind his back to Berman. He's at the 35-40. Brought down at the 40-yard line. Going to be a couple yards short. Mark Bergman running with the ball.
Tackled by number 12, Charmaine Washington.
Charmaine Washington. Rodney Troop, the senior, stepping up to make the tackle. A lot of open field there, but they were able to stay in their lanes and bring the running back down.
So fourth down, they're going to punt it away.
Number 37.
The ball at the 39-yard line.
For a punt for the Vikings. Deep for the Packers, number 7, Trey Scott.
Back at a single safety for Colquitt is Trey Scott. Punt will come from about the 30-yard line. 4 minutes, 11 seconds to go in the first quarter. Colquitt leading 3-0. Kick is away, nice high spiral. No fair catch. He catches it to 27, catches it across to 30, breaks a tackle, and he's brought down at the 34-yard line. 4 minutes to go in the first quarter. We'll take a timeout.
You and your dog have an understanding that could run deeper than you ever imagined.
Suddenly there were dogs doing something that not even chimps could do.
Dogs Decoded on Nova.
Tuesday at 8 on GPB.
First and 10 for Colquitt at the 34-yard line of Colquitt, leading 3-0, 4 minutes to play in the first quarter. Georgia Public Broadcasting Game of the Week from Moultrie, Georgia, in the heart of Region 1, Class 5A. First down throw out in the flat to Smith. He catches it, maybe gains 2 or 3 yards, brings up second down and 7.
Good job by Taquan Lang, Trey Jackson, and Justin Evans to swoop in and wrap him up, because he had a lot of momentum moving forward, and he could have probably stretched that to about 5 or 6 more yards.
Ty Smith in a traditional tight end position. We talked a little bit about this the first time we saw them play. He's going to have to play out in the receiver position in college unless he puts on a lot more weight, but he's a tough tight end at the high school level. Back to throw is Seagrace. On second down, he throws the ball out in the flat to Smith on the other side. Catches the ball just short of the first down, but his own second effort gets him a first down. Across the 45-yard line to the 47-yard line. And we were just talking about him lining up as a tight end on the left side. He ran all the way across the field to catch the ball and then just made it all on his own effort to get the first down.
Tevin Brown really doing his best to bring Ty Smith down. But when you're that big, it's really, really tough, especially when you've got open field. And like I said before, the momentum he had just carrying himself forward. But good job by Tevin Brown.
First and 10 from the 47-yard line of Colquitt. Man flanked on the right-hand side of Seagraves. This time they put Smith in motion. He stops, and now he comes back the other way. First and 10. Seagraves back to throw. Out to Smith again. Across midfield, maybe to the 49-yard line. Picks up about 5 yards on first down. And they feel like they've just got to get that score. The fourth or fifth catch already for Smith.
Same thing with the first possession that they had. The second possession. Just a short 5-6 yard throws. They're bringing Ty Smith. He's coming out, and he's coming this little sideline route. Nice cushion between the defensive back and the receiver. But Taquan Lang did a real good job putting helmet to chest and bringing him down.
Colquitt again getting good yardage on first down to bring up a second down and very manageable. Trying to do a little bit of a hurry up. They handed the second man through. That's Woodyard. He's cutting and he's going to be brought down just short of the first down. And again, it looked like he was getting close to the first down if he had just kind of plowed forward. But he cut back out to the outside trying to make a bigger play. We'll bring up third down in a couple, as he actually, I don't know if he had the first down, but he was a lot closer than he ends up being by cutting back there.
Tevin Brown doing a good job of wrapping up the legs of Woodyard and really preventing them from keeping this drive going forward.
Still third and manageable from the 46-yard line of Lowndes. Seagraves with a direct snap, looks to his left, throws it out in the flat, and the ball is going to be good defensive play there, very good defensive play. The intended receiver was Matt Saylor. And I think they'll bring a fourth down, but there is a flag on the play, so let's wait and see what the call is on this one.
Well, the crowd, the Colquitt crowd, really wants pass interference. It's going to be close.
They called something against Lowndes. I thought that was just a real good defensive play there.
Yeah, the ball and the defender kind of made it there at the same time, and those were really tough plays to call. But sometimes it goes in your favor, sometimes it doesn't.
I believe it was Brandon Roberts who made the defensive play there. Actually, Devontae Watts who made the defensive play. But the ball's still in the same spot, fourth down and 3. So they must have picked up the flag here. They're going for it from just across midfield at the 46-yard line. The line to make is the 43. Maybe they were just trying to get him to jump here. Let's see what they do now. Now, this quarterback can pooch kick, and I think that's what he's going to do here right now. He kind of signaled something with his feet. We've seen him do this before, and that's what he does. He kicks it away, and the ball will bounce at the 20-yard line, and it's going to actually be picked up. So Lowndes, the ball is ruled down. The ball got away, and everybody's running around, but the referee quickly signaled the ball is down. Colquitt's going crazy, but the ball was ruled down at the 18-yard line. So we'd seen the pooch kick ourselves, and maybe we took a little too long to get it off, but Lowndes was able to get back. If that ball bounced, instead of being caught in the air, it probably would have bounced inside the 10-yard line. So that was a very good, well-scouted play. When we talked to Wayne Grandy, he talked about having some of the best coaches in the country come to South Georgia to coach, because, and I think you just got an example of it right there, because that play could have gone and gotten them in very deep field position back at the inside the 10-yard line, but they scouted it, they knew what to do, and they quickly retreated and saved a big defensive play. They'll get the ball not in great field position, but at the 16 rather than inside the 10.
And right now, Taquan Lang, the team's second leading tackler, is down. He's making his way up now, and he's starting to walk off the field from here on our near side. But very, very questionable play for him as the ball is fading kind of to his right for him to kind of make an over-the-shoulder catch. And if we can see on the replay here, we're going to see the pooch from Colquitt. Looked like they might have been getting them to kind of jump off sides there and give them the first down. But the pooch kick, and it wasn't necessarily a direct kick to Lang, but he was trying to make a play, as we see here on the replay, the pooch kick. Kind of an over-the-shoulder catch, very risky catch there, and just lost control of the ball.
But he was on the ground, so it's first and 10 from the 16-yard line. Seagrove throws right-handed, but I guess he kicks left-footed. We'll have to see if he does that on every one of them. But the first down, handoff on the left side, not much there. Colquitt's defense has just been superior so far. That was Mike Moore running with the ball and maybe got back to the line of scrimmage. We'll call it second and 10.
Wright stepping up from his defensive tackle spot to make the play. And like I said earlier, these defensive lines are really kind of controlling this game now, not really giving up too many big plays. Aside from the one sack in the first possession, they're playing really, really well.
Second down and 10 from the 10-yard line. This is Moore with the ball again across the 20 to the 22. He'll bring up a third down and manageable as he gets 5 yards on second down to bring up third and 5. Wayne Jackson has 18 tackles. Smith has 34 tackles. Travis Register has already made a big stick tonight. He has 49 tackles, and Pittman has 33. That's a lot of tackles for the front four, who, as I said, usually just kind of set up the linebackers. But that's a couple hundred several hundred tackles between the front line of Colquitt. So now it's third down and 5. We're in the final minute of the first quarter. Colquitt leading it 3-0. Back to throw is the quarterback. Looks out on the right side and the ball is incomplete. It wasn't very close to him, but I actually think he got held a little bit on that one. And the referee was right there, and he shook it off. So I won't try to officiate from upstairs. I do want to remind people we will try to show you a couple of questions and scenarios that come up, rule interpretations of things that are a little bit different in high school football. Our good friends at the Georgia Athletic officials, and they did catch that. I don't think they called pass interference, Josh. I think they called defensive holding. The fans on this side didn't like it, but I think he grabbed him.
Jamal Phillips, he kind of hooked the receiver a bit with his arm as he turned to make the play. So the ref was standing right there. So 9 times out of 10, you're not going to get away with that one.
And it was enough for the first down, and that is one difference between high school and the other levels of play. Defensive holding is not an automatic first down, so you had to earn it with the yardage, which they did. Ball up to the 33-yard line, first and 10. We're in the final minute of the first quarter. Quarterback keeper up the left side, picks up maybe 3 yards as he squirted across the 35-yard line, brings up second down and 7.
Not too many penalties thus far, but I think one of the things that Coach Prost wanted to work on was cutting those down. They had 13 penalties for 141 yards last week in the loss to in the win. But, you really got to work on that because that's really not going to help your team.
15 seconds to play. There'll be one more play at least in the first quarter. Colquitt jumps offsides, and again, no offsides in high school football. That's called encroachment. At the other level of high school and college and pros, in that situation like that, you can jump back and get back as long as you don't touch. But in high school, as soon as you encroach the football, there's a penalty called, and we might get a description of that later on from one of our officials that's helped us from the Georgia Athletic Association. But that will take a second down and 8 and make it second down and 2 or 3 as the 5-yard penalty marched off.
If you're Colquitt's defense, you really don't want to keep putting this team in a position where they're not working for the yards that they're getting. Like I had mentioned, all those penalties last week, they really got to cut that down because that's going to put the other team in a position to make great plays.
Clock is ticking down. I think we've seen the last play of the first quarter. They're going to just settle on second and 2 to run a play after the first quarter is completed. It'll be the first play of the second quarter. So we've played 12 minutes of high school football from Tom White Field and MacTharp Stadium in Moultrie, Georgia. The score, the Packers have Colquitt 3. The Vikings have Lowndes nothing. We'll be back with the second quarter after this timeout.
back at Tom White Field at Mack Clark Stadium for the GPB Friday night game of the week. We've got the Colquitt Packers and the Lowndes Vikings. Score is 3-0 as we kick off the second quarter. A little back and forth in the first quarter between the two teams. An early turnover and then a couple of stalled drives. And here we are as Lowndes has the ball at their own 40-yard line. First and 10, second and 41-yard line. Quarterback hands off on the right hand side. He's brought down. They're still on the seat. Cuts it back now. He's still at the 40. Cuts it to the 41. 45-50. Midfield. 35-yard line. And out of bounds at the 35-yard line. 36-yard line. They waited him on the right side. The play wasn't there. So Nicholas Bradman.
First out of bounds by number 52. John Gray and number 12, Jermaine Washington.
Absolutely impressive.
First down for Mike.
There. It looked like they were kind of running a halfback option as they gave him the ball. He rolled out to the right. Looked like he was going to pack and throw, brought it down. And I think he might have faked the defense a bit. A lot of guys probably jumped and anticipated the throw, and he was able to come back to the near side and pick up some yards.
First and 10, they've inside towards the first time they've earned it, I guess we could say, since they got the turnover the first time, but they've moved it
back. First downs, has the field position at the 36-yard line, first and 10 from there. Quarterback sends Bergman in motion. Fakes the handoff to him. Quarterback keeps the ball himself. He's trying to 35 to the 31-yard line. Picks up a nice manageable first down of 5 yards.
Bull Barge coming in to make the play there. A freshman getting some playing time here in this big game and really kind of showing why he deserves to be out there on the field as he's able to bring down the Lowndes quarterback, Jarrell, who's really not that easy of a tackle.
That is one of our favorite names from the season so far, the Bull, and he's only a freshman, will obviously only get better. Clock moving around, 11 minutes to play in the first half. Lowndes driving the ball, back to throw. Down the field it comes, complete, 25, 20, 15, 10, all the way down near the goal line, brought down just short of the goal line. Big gain that time for 24 yards. I believe that was 84 with it.
I believe so, yeah.
All right, anyway, they got inside the 5-yard line. They're going to call it first and goal from the 2-yard line. Nick Hammings, who's not even in our 2-deep, is the one who I believe caught that ball and brought it down. Knew what to do with it after he caught it, Josh. He caught it at the 20, broke a tackle there, and got all the way down to the 2-yard line where it'll be first and goal, maybe even closer to the 1. Handoff goes to Moore. Moore tries the left side, and I think he's going to be stopped just short.
Nice push by the Colquitt defense. They're on backs against the wall. It's the goal line defense, and with, like I spoke about, Moore and Bergman and D. Daniels, the running backs that Lowndes have, they really did a good job of getting great penetration and keeping them out of the end zone.
One man name we haven't heard a lot yet is D. Daniels. He's got 8 touchdowns, and I don't see him directly in the backfield right now. The handoff is to Moore again. This time he's in for the touchdown. Right off the left guard and the left tackle, that's Jared Davis. He goes 285, and Larry Scarborough, he goes 260. So they ran off the left side and into the end zone for the touchdown.
Nice hole opened up there by the Lowndes offensive line, and Moore is able to just dive in and get the touchdown.
Seems like the momentum has been mainly in Colquitt's favor, but all of a sudden the score isn't as Lowndes scores the touchdown and gets the lead 6-3.
I think they're doing a great job. You kind of want to take the crowd out of it. Like I said, this can be considered a home game for both teams, even though we are at Tom White Field at MacTharp Stadium, but both the schools are fairly close together, so not that far of a travel for the other visiting team.
Matthew McInstein is in to try the extra point. He is not the regular kicker. He kicks it through. He is their normal punter. Dante Robinson is usually the quarterback or the kicker, but that was McInstein kicking the extra point to make it 7-3. And I believe Rachel Daniels has someone on the sidelines for us to talk to you. Rachel.
All right, thanks, Bob. So far the game is great, and I just want to let you guys know that we have a fantastic halftime show with you. We have met up with the principal from Colquitt County earlier today, and the principal from Lowndes County is here, and he's going to talk to us, and he actually has a great big surprise for everybody. So, you know, I guess we'll just see how things go. But I have to say, ever since we came to Colquitt, You guys are just fantastic to us. We had a chance to meet with the teachers, the students. I actually had a chance to speak with somebody's class, Mrs. Jones, who's actually the wife of the principal of Colquitt County. So I want to thank you guys for welcoming us in. So as we go on, I'll tell you more about our visit and our trip to Colquitt and everything. So let's get back to Bob and Fletcher.
Hey, Rachel, thanks a lot. You're absolutely right. The hospitality that we've received down here. You have a picture right now, by the way, of the Lowndes band. If you count the dancers that come with it, there's 550 people, 13 buses and a semi-trailer truck to deliver all their equipment tonight. And Rachel mentioned we will also be talking to both band directors at halftime, and Colquitt has like 200 in their band. But even they were laughing and saying it's about half the size of the Lowndes band. The Bridgemen put on quite a show. And here's the kickoff. It's another pooch kick. This one will be caught at the 30-yard line. No fair catch this time. Falls forward about the 35-yard line where they'll have excellent field position. That's the one thing about that pooch kick that you do. You don't have any run backs, but you give awful good field position. Here it'll be at the 36-yard line.
Yeah.
And there's a flag down as well. Let's see who they're talking to on this one. Usually it goes against the offense, but in a play like this, we'll wait and see. Personal foul against Colquitt. So that's going to take that field position I was talking about and wipe it right off. It'll go back to they called it against both teams. So the ball will stay right at the 36. So they call a personal foul on both Colquitt and Lowndes.
Things starting to get a little chippy here.
I was going to say.
Prior to the game, there was kind of a bit of a standoff. Nothing too flagrant, nothing too over the top. But with the tension here and the atmosphere, I could bet things just getting a little chippy down there on the field.
And the referees were wise to stop it as early as they can. Seagraves with Will Woodyard at his flank. He gets up the ball to him at the 35-40, 45-yard line and brought out of bounds. And now another flag, and I think this is going to go against, I guess you'd have to call it headhunting by the defensive man of Lowndes. Ted hit him very high.
Matt Frazier really lowering the head, but in the same token, I mean, Woodyard wasn't backing down. He said, come on, and kind of had a couple words for Frazier afterwards.
So the play picked up 8 yards. The penalty will add 15 more on it. That will take them into Lowndes territory. I'm sure Randy McPherson wants to see that spirit but doesn't want to see this. They score a touchdown, get the lead, get the momentum away, and now after just two plays, the ball's back in his own territory.
Yeah, it's you can't be as rabid as this Colquitt County crowd is. You're really just only going to amp it up a couple notches when you start giving up field position.
And when you have a hit like that high up on the Colquitt side, the crowd's going to react. But that referee had the flag out right away. It was clear that it was just a helmet-on-helmet tackle. Seagraves from the shotgun, hands to Woodyard. Woodyard crossed the 40, still on his feet, gets down to about the 37-yard line. It was back a long time ago, Josh, they had tearaway jerseys, and that man there had him by the jersey, and he just kept pulling him like it was a tearaway jersey. Took about a 2-yard gain and made it a 7-yard gain. Brings up second down and short. Now the referees are stopping play again for a moment here. Just not quite injured man again. Somebody down from Colquitt. One of the linemen is down for Colquitt. Second down and 3. And it seems like the key to this is what you do on first down. I guess that happens in most football games. But Colquitt, when they get 6-7 yards on first down, they're just a totally different offense.
Absolutely. And when you have the versatility of Cole Seagraves, and it's Preston Mobley who's down now, one of their outstanding offensive linemen. But when you have Cole Seagraves and you have the options that you have, if you start picking up those yards, I mean, it just makes everything so much easier.
9 minutes, 55 seconds to play in the first half. Lowndes leading Colquitt 7-3. We've got some great shots of right now we're looking at the injured player, but some great shots of the crowd. A full house here. The stadium holds 9,000. Josh, they put up some temporary bleachers in the end zone down there. That adds another 1,000. They're going to estimate they're going to have over 10,000 people here tonight. And you look at some of them here. In South Georgia, it's a special thing. I don't think it's easy to overstate. And Rachel was talking about how well they've treated us down here. And I want to mention, you're seeing messages for the Hampton Inn. We're all staying there. They've taken great care of us. The people in Moultrie who had to set up the line for us to have this game. And that was a little bit of a difficulty. The mayor, Amy Johnson from the city, was very helpful. Roger King, the head of utilities. All those people came out and just did yeoman's work. And, of course, Monday was a holiday, so we were working on a short week on top of everything else. we just couldn't have been treated better this week.
Absolutely. This is my first trip and my first experience with real South Georgia football, and I got to say this has been an absolutely wonderful experience, and I'm just ecstatic to be here.
I can tell you it's my first time in Moultrie, my first time in Thomasville where we're staying, and I saw more cotton fields since I've been in here today. It's a big cotton crop down here, so we're learning a lot as our geography here on the Georgia Public Broadcasting Game of the Week. Seagraves keeps it on second down, gets it across the 35-yard line. I believe he's going to be just a little short, but it'll bring up third and very short for the Packers of Colquitt County.
Really trying to get that push from the offensive line and trying to find some rush from space up the middle, but it's really been tough throughout the game for them for either team to find holes up the middle.
Well, we're near Florida, so we can make a reference to the new quarterback for the Denver Broncos, Tim Tebow. And we really did feel that last time Seagraves ran a lot like him. He was not as patient as we remember him being last time. Maybe let that play set up a little bit. He took off running pretty quickly with that. Third down and short from the 35-yard line, a yard to make his 34. Woodyard has that first down and more as he cuts across the 33-yard line. Quickly the hole stopped, but not before he had the first down.
Good job by Trey Jackson stepping up. Josh Clemens, the entire linebacking corps for Lowndes has really played great. Not seeing as much aggressiveness and penetration from the defensive line that we're used to seeing, but the linebackers are kind of stepping up and kind of shouldering the load from the defensive line.
They say the offensive line had a good push there as they got the first down, but it closed down quickly. The ball at the 33-yard line, first and 10 for Colquitt. One man flanking the quarterback, Seagraves. Snap, back to throw, looking left. Down the field, he throws it. Man open at Smith, and he has the ball just go off his hands inside the 10-yard line. And that was very similar to the pass that was in front of us before, Josh, where it just looked like it was a step or two from being caught. But another good throw. I'm not quite sure Smith is finishing the route there. That's my observation on both of those, that he just seemed – the ball was overthrown, but if you're finishing the route, you get a little closer to him than he was able to do on that one.
Yeah, Bob. It might be a situation where Seagraves' eyes are getting a little too big, and he's kind of seeing – Smith open, and he's kind of just throwing it a little excited, just a little too excited on the throw.
Number 68 is the center for them. He was out the first time we played. He missed the first four games with a very serious injury, but he's back. He's an all-state player. Now the quarterback is in his grasp, but he gets the ball off. Cooper catches the ball at the 30, 25, 20, and he has the first down. What a great play made there by number 10. That was not Cooper. That was Matt Saylor, who bailed out Seagraves as he was in the grasp and going down. And he found Saylor out in the flat, and he caught the ball and just barely made the first down at the 23-yard line. I'll be honest, I'm surprised they didn't call the quarterback in the grass there.
James, James Mathis, one of the most versatile defensive players. Kevin Giddens, the offensive line coach of Colquitt, had said, we have to worry about this guy. Almost brought Seagraves down, but he was able, with power, to just get the ball out.
From the 22-yard line. Hand off to Cooper. Cooper gets it to the 20, and he's knocked back there, second down and 8.
Handful of Lowndes Vikings coming in to make that tackle. And I was speaking about James Mathis, 34 tackles. He's got 4 sacks, 7 tackles for loss as Mobley kind of limps his way back onto the field. You got to love the heart of this guy. He said, Coach, I got to get back in there. You got to put me back in there. We're close enough to the end zone. I want to be part of this.
6'2", 300 pounds goes Preston Mobley. He's flanked on his inside there by just a baby Dalton Dillon at 285. So they've grown big down here in Moultrie, and now I believe they've called a timeout. Let's see if Rachel's got anything on the sideline for us to talk to. 7 minutes and 29 seconds, Lowndes leading Moultrie. Rachel, you want to talk anything more about what's going on down there and other things that you saw while you were in Moultrie?
Ready? Okay, well, Bob, I don't know. We saw a little bit of everything. We actually met up with the mayor earlier today. He's just a fantastic man. He wasn't actually able to attend the game because he said he's going to a whole bunch of family's weddings, but he definitely appreciates us for broadcasting the game and to be down here in Colquitt. They love GPB, and now GPB, of course, we love them. And, you know, just today has been fantastic. Like I said, just meeting up with the principal. We actually had a chance to meet up with some football players who baked us cakes just to show their school spirit. And there's actually a kicker on the field who has a complete fan club. I'm pretty sure that you'll find out who he is soon. All that will be during the halftime. So I think the game is getting ready to come back. So let's see what's going on.
So you have football players baking cakes down here? So we'll be back to play your second down and nine from the 20-yard line. Rachel came down here, and Josh, she almost all the features that we have at halftime, mm-hmm. we normally do those over the course of two or three days.
Yeah.
She and Patrick, her fine editor slash videographer, just did a great job to get the features that we have throughout the night, and we look forward to it. Thanks a lot for a great job, Rachel. Second down and nine. Hand off, the quarterback keeps the ball and tries the left side and did not get much of anything. They take the ball to Woodyard. Seagraves took it himself and ran the left side, and they call it no gain, third down and nine from the 20.
Well, the Colquitt County offensive line opened up a nice hole there, but unfortunately Trey Jackson, the linebacker for Lowndes, saw it and was able to fill it and bring down the halfback before he could get any positive yards.
7-3, we've got 7 minutes to go in the first half. Lowndes leading Colquitt. Colquitt on the edge of the scoring zone. At the 20-yard line, Woodyard flanked on the right side of Seagraves. Man comes in motion, that's Trey Cooper. Goes all the way through this time. Back to throw with Seagraves. And now the clock, or the referees blow time. Let's see what we've got. Timeout Colquitt. So that call, I think that timeout came from the bench rather than from the field, because they were ready to run the play there. But Russ Pro saw something he didn't like and called the timeout. Prost is still an offensive guy. No matter how much he talks about the defense, he still mm-hmm. likes to score a lot of points. Rachel mentioned weddings. That's where Fletcher Proctor is today. And Josh, how do you feel doing your first game for Georgia Public Broadcast? We're glad to have you.
Nah, it's a pleasure, and I feel absolutely fantastic being up here in the press box with you. And like I said, experiencing this whole South Georgia football atmosphere. The crowd is absolutely raucous. They're stomping their feet. They're reacting to every single play on the field. Big hits, they're getting loud. Missed calls, they're getting loud. It's been an absolute fantastic game.
And Josh, you've been with us for 4 years, and you do
yes,
the
sir.
Dirty work. Tell us what you do normally on these games.
Well, typically on these games, I'm part of the video crew. You will get here a few hours before everybody else. Empty stadium, and we'll just kind of get our cameras set up, get our sound equipment set up. The great people, Andy Richardson, Sean Bond in the truck, Rob, Pat, everybody. Just a great team. We get out here and we make sure you guys are able to catch these games every week on the GPP Friday Night Game of the Week.
And we're sure glad to give you an opportunity to do this, because you've worked very hard for us for 4 years. It's 80, 90, maybe even 95 degrees when we start this in August, and it's in the teens when we finish. And you guys are out there in the elements no matter what it is. We really appreciate what you've done, and we're glad to have you in the booth tonight.
Well,
third down and nine from the 20-yard line. Seagraves back to throw. Over the middle, he's got Smith. Inside the five, he rolls down towards the 3 or 2 yard line. We'll see where they set him down. But in any event, it is clearly a first down and first and goal.
About a foot or so away from the goal line. Daquan Lang has been really struggling today guarding Ty Smith. I mean, I don't know if that's his primary defensive assignment, but he's been really struggling. It's been tough for him. I know there's a big size difference, about 5-6 inches between the
that's
two.
That's what I was just looking. It's at least 6 inches there. And I'm not sure that Smith hasn't grown a little bit since the season started. Now they're in the T formation on first down. And the whistle blows as they run the play, and it dies in the end zone. But the whistle clearly blew before they snapped the ball. And this is a pure T. I remember the last time they were when we saw a call quit. Not the wishbone, not any people coming out of motion. It's the old T formation, Chicago Bear style, 1940s style.
Well, when you've got an offense like that with Seagraves, Woodyard, and you've got Trey Cooper, you're kind of able to run that offense because you're able to move the ball on the ground in so many ways. You necessarily don't have to throw. But when you have a weapon like Ty Smith, you know, it keeps the defense honest. It keeps them. I'm surprised that Colquitt is really spreading out Lowndes' defense.
The man who actually dove for the ball last time was Tony Smith, and they actually have a lineman in there. 52 is the fullback who ran with the ball, and he's got it again, and he is in for the touchdown. That's Caleb Clark, who comes in and plays the fullback position, scoring the touchdown for Colquitt and putting them back out in front, 9-7. Game seesawing back and forth. 6:19 to play. Caleb Clark, the normal guard, came in and ran it in for the extra point, or for the touchdown to take it 9-7. In to try the extra point now is Oscar Luna. Kick is up and through. So with 6 minutes and 19 seconds to play, Colquitt back out in front, 10-7. Rachel's down on the field. Let's see if she's got another feature she'd like to talk about. We'll go to Rachel Daniels on the field here. 6:19 to play.
Well, actually, all of our features is definitely during halftime. And we did something special, but you guys are actually going to have to log on to gpb.org/sports tomorrow to check out the Hey Did You Know blog featuring members of Maltrick City's community. It's actually fantastic. But Bob and Josh, you have to feel the intensity down here. I know you can probably see it, but to see the fans and everybody just jumping up and the band. As you can see, Colquitt County's band is not here right now because they're gearing up for their halftime show. So I can't wait to check you guys back at halftime. So let's get back to the game.
The press box is actually rattling right now with the people jumping up and down. I was going to ask Rachel, maybe she can comment later about we're staying actually in Thomasville at the Hampton Inn over there, and they've been taking great care of us. And so the folks at Thomasville, who have a pretty good game tonight too, with Thomas County Central hosting Northside Warner Robins. Big game in Class 4A just down the road here. So they play pretty good football at 4A as well as 5A. And, oh, by the way, how about 1A with Wilcox, Charlton, and Clinch down here? So high school football at all levels, and I didn't even talk about 3 with Mary Persons and Peach Plain tonight as well, too. Kick is all the way back to the 10, 15, 20. Cuts it at the 25, brought down at the 27-yard line. That's Nick Brigman running with the – I can't pronounce his name. I'm having a mental block, but he can't return to the 20. We have not called the name of D. Daniels yet. That is Nick Bergman with
not
the ball.
All.
But I don't know if D. Daniels is hurt, but he is one of their big three, 386 yards rushing coming into this game with 8 touchdowns, and we have not called his name yet. We've called Bergman a lot running with the ball and catching the ball and just coming out of the wingback position. So he's shown the most versatility. They really haven't gotten their all-stater, our score 44, Josh Clements, too much. We haven't called his name very often yet either.
Yeah, shaken up earlier on in the game. But, yeah, like you said, no D. Daniels, not that much, and not much Clements.
Second down and 9, quarter, or first down and 10, rather, back to throw. Chased out of the pocket, looking for a man. He's going to be hit and brought down at the 20-yard line, shoulder-to-shoulder tackle. The quarterback kind of ducked down, anticipating that. So some of the fans were thinking that might be a, especially with a quarterback running with the ball. But once he gets out of the pocket, he's basically a running back. And when he lowers his head, that was just a good, here's the play right here. Let's see it.
Second and 18.
Brought down hard at the 20-yard line.
Yeah, John Gray, Brett Smith, just a lot of the Colquitt really doing a great job of not buying in to the fake from Jarrell and really forcing the loss of yards there.
Loss of 9 on the play. First or second down and 19. Quarterback on a direct snap tries the left side and gets next to nothing. Maybe a yard will bring up third and very, very long.
Another great play from that Colquitt County defensive line. Jarrell trying to find some room up the middle, but really the defensive line did a great job staying in the lanes, controlling the blocks, and not letting Jarrell get out or get in and pick up any positive yards.
Third down and 18 from the 21-yard line. Clock goes under 5 minutes to play in the first half. Colquitt leading it 10-7. All their crowd up on their feet. Players exhorting them to get even louder here. Third down and 19. Back to throw. Flags are down and the throw's out in the flat incomplete. Let's see what the penalty is. Came down immediately, but back very far back from the field. Judge, that one's got me a little confused because it was the type of penalty that came early from the back.
Mm-hmm.
Sideline warning, so that will just be that's why they called it from there. And the, so no play. They're now going to say fourth down, and I'm a little confused at that. Don't they get third down over again?
Well, too much energy on that Colquitt County sidelines. I mean, you want everybody to be in the game.
Why is it fourth down if there was a penalty?
But I wish I had an answer.
But I guess it was a warning, so there was no penalty administered, so the play stands. And now it's fourth down, and they'll be kicking away from their own 5-yard line. The kick will actually come from the 10. Good snap. Kick is away. High spiral. Back to receive it, and they let it bounce at the 50. Bounces away down to the 40-yard line. It'll go out of bounds right there at the 40-yard line. First and 10 for Colquitt from there. I want to remind you that the Georgia Athletic officials are looking for some officials. If you have a passion for high school sports, you're looking to earn some extra money, or you've ever thought just about becoming an athletic official, the Georgia Athletic Officials Association is seeking to recruit new officials to high school sports played in Georgia. They need them for soccer, lacrosse, all the new sports that have gone on. They need them for football. Officials earn enough to make a car payment, take a vacation, or pay for their children's braces. Officials are needed for all sports. Go to GAOA.com to find out more about it. First and 10, a handoff goes to a quarterback keeper, rather, and he gains maybe 3 yards across the 40 to the 43-yard line.
The versatile James Mathis coming over from his defensive tackle position to make the play. 6'2", 270. The senior is very, very athletic, very explosive. Like I said earlier, he's one of the guys that Colquitt is really going to have to watch out for.
Second down and 7 from the 43-yard line. Seagraves throws it to Woodyard. Woodyard across the 45 up to about the 48-yard line. They'll bring up third down and a couple yards from there. The line to make is exactly at midfield, and they're going to put the ball at the 48-yard line, so third and 2.
Matt Frazier, Trey Jackson from the defense of Lowndes stepping up to make that tackle, stopping him short from the first down.
Clock stopped at 4:08 with them getting out of bounds. They should circle the play to start here again shortly. Third down and 2 from the 48-yard line. Colquitt leading 10-7. One man flanking the quarterback. They hand it to him. And Woodyard has the first down and more. It crosses midfield up to the 47-yard line of Lowndes. First and 10, Colquitt.
They're really riding Willie Woodyard tonight. I mean, the guy has been an outstanding running back. Like I said, taking over for Tevin King is no easy task. But with Trey Cooper, Willie Woodyard, and Cole Seagraves, they really are able to produce enough rushing yards.
400 yards coming into the game running. He's got 18 catches, so he's got nearly 600 yards of total offense. And he and the receiver Smith have been most of the offense tonight so far, of course, throwing in the quarterback. Hand to Woodyard again, across the 45, down to about the 43-yard line. Push back there will bring up third down and 6 or 7 yards to go. Again, there's great push by this front line of Colquitt, but then Lowndes seems to close it very quickly after a couple of yards there.
Absolutely, Bob, and I think a lot of it is kind of panic sets in, and the defense really says, look, we really need to step up. This team is kind of pushing us back way too much. So we've got to man up. We've really got to step our game up, and we really got to control the big plays.
Two receivers to the top, two receivers to the bottom. Spread formation right now. Nobody really behind Seagraves. Throws the ball out in the flat. Caught at the 45, 40. Very close to the first down, knocked out of bounds at the 39-yard line. It was Fred Phillips making the catch there. First time we've called his name. He only has 3 receptions on the year, but that was one for him coming out of the spread formation and running a gain of about 5 yards. Brings up almost the same distance as last time, third, maybe 2.5 this time.
I know we're a little higher up here in the press box, but that's a little guy there.
But 5'8", 160 pounds. You are correct,
you
sir.
You got to love the heart. I was looking for a pass play to Trey Smith, Ty Smith there, but, you know, it might have been just a decoy, that play.
Now two running backs to the left side of Seagraves. They run to the left. Seagraves pitches it out to Trey Cooper. Cooper cuts back at the first down. I think he stretched it there and just barely made it. That stretch of the ball by Cooper got the ball across the first down yardage and gave him the needed distance to the 36-yard line.
Nice spin move by Cooper to kind of get the extra yards, extend his body, extend his arms out there. Tevin Brown did all he could to bring him down, but he was kind of just able to get the yards, and I'm not sure if they're going to give him. It's going to be fourth and one.
I think you're right. I think they've said that stretch that I was acknowledging, the referees didn't see it the same way. So instead of putting the ball at the 36, they said his knee touched at the 37, and we've got fourth and inches, and a timeout has been called here with 2 minutes and 37 seconds. Big fourth down play coming up here, Josh.
Yeah, and this is kind of one of the type with about 2.5 minutes left in the first half. Of course, Colquitt is leading, but you want to kind of keep that momentum going. You really want to, I don't necessarily say put your foot on the throat of the opponent, but you really want to make a statement going into halftime, especially after last week, what both teams were through. Colquitt with the big win, Lowndes with the heartbreaking loss. And it's an amazing stat, but Colquitt is outscoring their opponents by something like 60 points in the second half.
And they only give up 7 points in the first quarter. So
yeah.
they are stingy at both sides of the ball. Now, we're going to have a third and inches, or fourth and inches. They've got the big quarterback, Seagrave. I would expect him to get the ball, but they got the big bodies coming in, including the man who scored the touchdown. At least he was in. Yeah, he's coming in. They're going to be in that T formation, and Caleb Clark will be the center point of that. So let's see what they do right here. Quarterback under center this time. Now they're kind of in a wishbone in reverse this time. The handoff goes to the big guy. He's got the first down at the 35-yard line, and he likes jumping up there in the huddle. He had a lot of momentum there as he had the first down, and then he leaped through the air. And Mr. Clark goes 230 pounds, so when he jumps, he's taking a lot of the gravity with him as well.
John Gray, the linebacker, like you alluded to earlier, that Chicago Bears offense when they had Refrigerator Perry on the goal line, you know, get the big man, give him the ball, let him push that line forward, and Gray was able to leap over the line and pick up the first down.
And I was laughing because when he came, he's a defensive lineman, and so when he came off the field, he did that hip bump that's become so famous or so regular of all football.
Yes.
With his defensive line coach, there must have been 500 plus pounds in the air there as they joined hips in the air, and the crowd loved it, and there was just a little good sideshow here as we stop the clock with 2 minutes and 33 seconds to play, and Colquitt leading 10-7, heading towards halftime. Lots of features coming up with Rachel Daniels. We'll be talking to the band directors. We'll be talking to both principals and looking forward to learning more about our visit to South Georgia. Man in motion's Trey Cooper. Comes through now. The snap will come to the quarterback. Back to throw. Has time. Over the middle he goes to Smith. He makes the catch again inside the 20. Falls forward down to the 16 or 17-yard line. That was a big-time play, Josh.
Absolutely. And it was the matchup we talked about. Ty Smith just seems to be just totally way too much for the defensive back.
A man among men right there. And that's where I think he's going to play in the college level, is just that possession receiver out of the wingback position, not the tight end, but he's a heck of a high school tight end. On first down, they give the ball to Wood, and they stop him cold. Woodyard stopped for no gain here. 2 minutes to go in the first half, and it's been a back-and-forth game, but you just kind of feel like, for the most part, Colquitt has had the control of this. It's only a three-point game right now, so a very important time for the Lowndes defense here in the last 2 minutes.
Yeah, I think Colquitt is doing a great job of just spreading the field out, spreading the Lowndes defense out. The Lowndes defensive line has 10 sacks on the season, 34 tackles for loss, but they're not able to bring all that pressure on the line because the offense is so spread out.
Two men flanking Seagraves. Hands the ball to Woodyard. Woodyard back to throw. Left-handed toss. Man wide open in the end zone. Touchdown. And wow. That was Willie Woodyard out of the backfield, I think, making the catch. Nope. 18, excuse me. Making the catch there for the touchdown. And if you've got a trick play in the book, what a great time to call it with 2 minutes to go in the first half. Actually, a minute and 28. And that young man was wide open in the sideline. So you've had a defensive lineman scoring a touchdown and a second stringer making a touchdown. I believe the extra point is up and good. And with a minute 28 seconds to play in the first half, it's Colquitt 17, Lowndes 7. And we'll keep it right here for right now. And Josh, that play caught everybody by surprise. And there was not a man within 10 yards of him.
Yeah. Looked like Willie Woodyard just faked the run, and he's been doing so well today on offense that he just, you know, the defense bit into it, and DJ Johnson, the junior, was wide open in the far corner of the end zone. And it's just one of those plays where you got to be kicking yourself when you're a defense that you let something that's a guy get that wide open, especially in a tight game. But now Colquitt extends its lead to 10 points with about a minute and a half left in the second quarter.
Johnson's seventh catch of the year, but his second touchdown. So he makes maximum use of those. Now Lowndes is not the type of offense that you would expect to open up here with a minute 28 to go. So I think a little bit will depend on what we depend to get here for a run back here, but they only have one timeout as well. So my guess is that Lowndes will be probably content to go to the locker room. Let's see what happens on the kickoff, however, first. Ball is caught at the 10, gives ground to the 5. It's Woodburn. He's at the 5, the 10, the 15. And breaks a tackle at the 25, 30. Brought from behind, 35, 40. Finally tackled at near midfield at the 48-yard line. Great run back there.
Nick Bergman, great run by Nick Bergman, just really keeping the feet going, keeping the legs going. And if we can see it on the replay here, cutting across field, doing, just making great moves, keeping the feet going, keeping the legs going, and that's really what you want from any offensive player, is to not just give up. I mean, you really got to have a lot of heart, especially on the kickoffs, because these guys are flying at you, and but there's so much open field.
And he was able to take a long time making. He fouled his blocking. He let things happen. The clock said 1:29. I just happened to catch that. So that was a 13-second run with the ball, and he just was very, very patient. Now with the ball at the 49-yard line, you're going to see Lowndes try to do something with the ball and get something on the scoreboard. Touchdown or field goal. Throw out in the flat and the screen pass to Bergman, and there was just overthrew him. Little excited, although it looked like it was well covered by Colquitt. So it's second down and 10 from the 49-yard line. That play would have probably only gone from 1:49 to the other. So pick up a 2 yards with only a minute 13. Probably just as well to let the go ball incomplete.
Yeah, I don't think necessarily Lowndes wants to really be too aggressive at this point in time. I mean, you're down 17-7. You don't want to, you know, make a bad turnover.
First or second and 10. The quarterback falls down. The ball's on the ground. Picked up. Gives ground to the 35-yard and tackled for a huge loss back to the 33-yard line. The quarterback, Jarrell, just lost his footing there. And as he went to the ground, the ball flew out. And Bergman was very lucky to pick up the ball on a bounce. And then he lost another 10 or 15 yards. That's usually the ball that you kind of want him to fall on. And now Colquitt, who only has one timeout left. Now they're saying Lowndes is taking a timeout. Why in the world would they take a timeout with 3rd and 25 coming up?
It's probably a panic play. I mean, I really don't think that, excuse me, that there are many options for them right now. I mean, after the huge loss, I mean, you really got to kind of settle the guys down. You got to get everybody focused, especially with under a minute left in the half.
He switched it. It was on Colquitt. It was not on you don't win as many state championships and win as many games as Randy McPherson has and call a timeout on 3rd and 25. So the referees just pointed in the wrong direction. So Colquitt has indeed burned their last timeout here with 58 seconds to play. And I would expect Lowndes just to run a ball and just take some time off the clock and kick it away, and Colquitt will only have a few seconds left and go to the locker room probably very happy to be ahead 17-7. Now, if they can block the kick on fourth down or cause a turnout on third down, you know, that would obviously change everything.
Yes.
But unless something happens here, you're going to see Lowndes run the ball, take 40 seconds off the clock, kick it away, and we'll get to halftime. But right now it's 17-7, the last 58 seconds. Quarterback under center this time. Hands off to Bergman. Bergman on the right side. 5, 10, 15 yards. He's back to his original line of scrimmage and will be brought down at midfield after picking up about 13 yards, almost back to the original line of scrimmage.
Picking up some good yards there. John Gray, the outstanding junior linebacker, sticking with him the whole way, able to bring him down.
The ball at the 47-yard line. The clock ticking along merrily here. We're into the final 30 seconds of the first half. So by the time they kick it away, there'll be very little time left, and they're going to let the clock run all the way down before they probably do call a timeout with just a few seconds left to get their kicker on the field. Under 20 seconds to play in the first half. Just waiting around, waiting for the referees to either call delay of the game or give them their timeout, clock down to 10 seconds. And still moving along, and the referee finally calls timeout with 6 seconds to play, so they barely even have to kick the ball here, Josh. They could just kind of run around here, but that's one of the things that we, you know, they're talking about getting 25-second clocks, and it would help so much, especially in a stadium like this where they could easily do that.
Yeah.
Dave Hunter, who is doing the television game tonight, and by the way, that's Flowery Branch at Heritage Conyers, he just says that there's just so much inconsistency on when they start the 25-second clock.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to be critical of the rest,
It
just seems to happen that way. They let almost 50 seconds go off the clock there, and, you know, so that's this I don't think it's going to make any difference because Colquitt didn't have any timeouts,
yeah,
but there's just that feeling of inconsistency that comes with that.
Yeah, and especially in a game like this where everything is, there's so much at stake. I mean, you kind of don't want to give anybody any kind of, you know, avenues to say, oh, well, this because of this or because of that. But, it's really tough. There's a little inconsistency there. But I think that in the long run, I mean, I don't think it'll really have any major effect on the game or the outcome.
I want to remind you, we've got halftime coming up. We're going to see both bands. We're going to talk to both principals, and we'll eventually talk to our representative on patch for physical fitness, and we'll shape rather. And so we'll be very busy at halftime. Just the essence of high school football tonight with 10,000 people here. Great crowd. Beautiful night for football. There's the snap. The kick is away. And that should just about run out the clock. High spiral. No one even back for Colquitt. The horn sounds as the ball still rolling on the ground. So we've played 24 minutes of high school football. The score, 17 for the homestanding Colquitt, 7 for the visiting Lowndes. We'll be back with our halftime.